Welcome everybody. As you know, this is the first occasion, the first activity in this new internal seminar of the Institute of Cosmos Sciences, today our first speaker will be Edgar Molina, but this is basically something that starts today, that will be every week, and it is activity that was planned in, in our Maria de Maestu program. So I think we're very proud to start this and to get it going. And at this time, I would like to thank especially Jorge Russo and Kazushi Iwasawa, who I asked them to, if they were would be ready to organize this activity and help the Institute. And I'm really very thankful to them, very grateful for having done a lot of work and having helped to really get this going. And so I hope that this will be very successful, and I encourage everyone's participation. And without anything else, I just want to pass it to Jorge and Kazushi so that they can say more about introducing this new activity. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jordi. Good morning, everybody, and thank you for attending this talk. As Jordi pointed out, the idea of these seminars is to have the opportunity to interact with other members of the Institute and, of course, to learn a bit more about the very interesting research that is currently carried out in different groups, right? And please recall that all PhD students and postdocs of the Institutes are invited to talk. So if someone would like to give a talk soon, say the next few months, for example, please send us a message and we will fix a convenient date. The talks are planned to be for non-specialists, colloquium style, and everybody, expert and non-experts, of course, are encouraged to ask many questions and generate discussions and comments. The talks will be 30 minutes, but it will work like a chess clock in the sense that the questions, discussions, comments will be counted, will not be counted in these 30 minutes. And we expect that the total duration of the talk will be around, say, 45 minutes. We should try not to exceed the 45 minutes so everybody can go to lunch. Today we will have a 10-minute coffee break in the middle of the talk, where people are free to do what they normally do in coffee breaks, for example, go for a coffee or ask questions to the speaker or chat with a colleague. So please, if you have any other suggestion, comment, remark on the organization of these events, please write to me or to Kazushi Iwasawa. And I now give the floor to Kazushi, who will say a few words also.
Thank you, Jorge. Well, about this seminar series, almost everything has been said by Jordi and Jorge. So with Jorge, we are chasing around all the young people for the future talks. So I would appreciate all your participation for the future seminar series. So I think we can start now. And today's speaker is Edgar Molina. He's a finishing PhD student from the High Energy Astrophysics Group. And he's telling us about outflows in the binary star systems. And we are totally aware that not everyone is familiar with this field. So any questions, however fundamental or elemental they are, all the questions are welcome. So, okay, so let's start the very first seminar of this seminar series. Please go ahead with.
Okay, thank you for the introduction. Sorry. I hope you can all see my screen and hear me well. Well, as Kazushi said, I'm a PhD student here in the High Energy Group, and I'm already finishing my thesis. I finished this summer, and today I will talk about what's been the main topic of this thesis, that are relativistic outflows in high mass binary systems, and in particular the interactions of these outflows with with the companion star. The results that I'm presenting here are mostly done in collaboration with Valentí Bos Ramón, who is one of my supervisors, together with Marc Ribó, and also Santiago del Palacio from the Instituto de Radioastronomía in Argentina. Okay, so this is the outline of my talk. First of all, I will just make a very general introduction to high mass binaries. Then I will focus on one scenario or one possibility for these systems that are microquasars, and especially in the interaction between the jets and the stellar wind. Then I think once I finish this this topic, we can make the break, and then I will go to the next scenario, which is a scenario with a non-accreting pulsar, in which the interaction happens between the wind of the pulsar and the wind of the star. And finally, I will just mention some additional elements that add complexity to these systems, but without going into much detail because I don't have enough time, and a short summary at the end. And please, if you have questions, just open your microphone and ask them. I cannot see the chat in full screen, so just open the microphone, please, and just ask them if you have. Okay, so just to start, a very small disclaimer at the beginning. This is just the sketch for stellar evolution. So depending on the mass of the star, which how the evolution goes. I will be focusing my talk in this upper part of the sketch. So massive stars, let's say above 8 solar masses or so. And I will talk, unless I say otherwise, I am talking always of either the massive star itself above 8 solar masses, or the remnants of the stellar evolution of such stars, namely black holes or neutron stars. So how are these high mass binary systems that I will talk about formed? We know, and actually there was a talk on this topic 2 days ago on Tuesday. We know that the stars form from the same molecular cloud that breaks and collapses under its own gravity. And we know that many stars are formed from the same cloud. So a significant fraction of these stars will be in binary systems, which means that our stars gravitationally bound to each other, orbiting around each other. And a fraction of this will be in closed binary systems, which is basically systems where the stars are so close that you can even have interactions between the outer layers of the stars, as you can see in this picture, for instance. So the two stars basically are very, very close to each other. Then what we have is that one of the stars may be significantly more massive than the other, so it evolves faster because it burns all its fuel faster. And when a massive star evolves, the end state of its life, it's either a black hole or a neutron star, which is what we call a compact object generically. So from this scenario, we go to something like this, where we still have a normal non-degenerate star and a compact object that in this picture would be in the center of this disk. And somehow they are interacting in some manner because they are still very close to each other. So we know right now around 10 objects of this type, depending on where we put the limit to consider them high mass or not. And all of them are located at distances typically of a few kiloparsecs. This combined with the orbital separation, so orbital separations in these systems are normally under below one astronomical unit, which is, for those of you that are not familiar with this, is the average distance between the Earth and the Sun. So they are very, very close and they are quite far away. Basically, this means that we cannot see them directly. So we cannot see the internal structure of this, or we cannot have an image of the internal structure of these objects, except for these outflows that I will talk about in a moment, that can go up to much farther distances. We cannot have an imaging of the internal structure of the objects themselves. So what we do is just propose scenarios in which the observed emission coming from these sources is feasible. And I will talk about the two main scenarios for this kind of sources, which are a compact object accreting matter from the companion star and launching relativistic jets, which is called a microquasar. And also another scenario where the compact object is a pulsar with a relativistic wind. So the first scenario, which is the microquasars, as I said before, is closed binary systems, where we have a compact object that would be in this sketch would be here at the center of this disk. Then is accreting matter from the companion star via an accretion disk. So this matter is spiraling inwards until it is accreted by the compact object. And part of the material that is in the very inner regions of this accretion disk is ejected at relativistic speeds perpendicularly to it. The exact mechanisms how this works is not yet fully understood. But we know that in this kind of objects, we see emission in a very broad frequency range. This is what I show here. For instance, we have optical emission from the star, of course, and also from the most outer regions of the accretion disk that are at temperatures where they emit thermal optical photons. Then if we go in the inner regions of the accretion disk, we have X-rays because these regions are much hotter. We have gamma rays coming from the regions of the jet very close to the launching site, to the compact object. And then moving away in the jets, we have also radio emission that can be traced up to very long distances. And this is just an example of an spectral energy distribution. So in the y-axis, we have the luminosity or the emitted power, and in the x-axis, the energy of the photons. And we can see here emission. This is for the particular case of a microquasar called Cygnus X3. We have emission here in radio wavelengths, optical, that is dominated by the star, X-rays, and gamma rays. So we have many orders of magnitudes in energy in the photon emission. Then what I will, as I said, these objects are possible either with a massive star or with a low mass star, say a solar type star. But I will focus on the case where this is a massive star, because then the interaction between the stellar wind, which is very powerful, and the jets then becomes important. And well, regarding the jets themselves, we know that they can extend up to very long distances of the order of many times the binary system themselves. And we also know that they are efficient sites for particle acceleration. So we have particles, charged particles, that can be accelerated up to energies above 1 TeV. And these particles accelerated, these ultra-relativistic particles, emit energy through different non-thermal processes. Let's say here I just show some of these processes that emit photons at this very broad wavelength range. Here we have synchrotron emission, which is the emission of photons when a charged particle is accelerated by a magnetic field. We have inverse compton, where a low energy photon is scattered by a relativistic electron up to higher energies. And we have also here Bremsstrahlung, which is just the acceleration of an electron by an ion. But these are just examples of these kind of processes, but just processes that are able to emit photons in a non-thermal way, let's say. So normally in stars, the emission that we see from stars is thermal. So every body at a temperature have some thermal emission. These processes are non-thermal and can emit photons in a very, very broad wavelength range. So going now to the topic itself of the interaction between these jets and the stellar wind of a massive star. One thing that is already quite intuitive is just if we have a jet that is originally going in the direction perpendicular to the orbital plane. So in this sketch would be in this direction. And we have a strong stellar wind that is hitting the jet from one side. One thing one may intuitively think is just, okay, so the jet is bent in the direction away from the star. And this is actually the case. So one can make estimations on how important is this bending, depending on the jet power and the wind speed and so on. But for typical parameters for massive stars and jets, it's of the order of 10 or 15 degrees, something like this, the bending with respect to the initial jet direction. So when one combines this bending with the orbital motion of the compact object around the star, what one gets is a sort of helix-like structure for the jet. This is what is sketched here. So this region would be the region close to the binary system where the jet is bent away from the star. But once the orbital motion becomes important, then one gets this kind of helix-like structure for the jet. Another thing that maybe it's not so intuitive is that the jet is propagating in a dense medium because the star has a powerful stellar wind. So the medium around the binary system is filled with star material. And what this makes is that, let's say we have an initially conical jet and the jet expands conically. This is what you can see here, for instance. In this simulation, the jet is moving to the right, so from left to right. And at the very first regions here, you can see that the jet is expanding conically, but it reaches a point where the pressure made by the medium becomes equal or higher than the pressure that the jet itself does in the lateral directions. And this makes this conical expansion to stop and recollimates the jet. So the jet is no longer expanding perpendicularly to its propagation. And another thing that this makes is that the jet material and the stellar wind material are mixed together. And as you can see here, for example, here in this plot, I'm showing these are simulations by Manuel Perucho of the jet propagation in a dense wind. Here, the white color is basically 100% jet material, and the black represents star material, so material from the stellar wind. So here we would have the star in the right. The wind is pushing the jet, and well, we can see that the jet is deviated to this direction, but only the very central regions are still white, so with a very high fraction of jet material, and we have all these gray regions where this is already full of, so it's just a mixture of jet and wind material here. And this already happens at the binary system scale. So these distances here is typically it's similar to the size of the orbital separations. So it happens already at small scales. And if we go to the extreme where the jet power is low, what may happen is that the jet is just disrupted, is destroyed by the stellar wind. These are just another simulation where you can see this effect. here you have the star and the upper part of this plot. The wind is pushing in this direction. And you can see here this jet already bent, and at some point then it's, well, it develops a lot of instabilities, and then we don't have a jet anymore. So already at these very small scales, the jets can actually be destroyed by the stellar wind if they are not powerful enough. Here I show some observations of very famous microquasars. The first one, which is Cygnus X3. This is, for example, one that is very clear that this helical structure is seen. What you can see here would be the binary system, and then you can see this clear curved jet. It's not clear what's the origin of this curvature, but it's there. So stellar wind may have an influence. There are other possible explanations, but it's not yet clear. Cygnus X1 is another very famous system also, but in this case, we cannot say much from observations of the jet if we observe this trend of a curved jet or not, because we don't have enough emission from the jets to claim a given shape. And this is another case that where this helical shape is very clearly seen. In this case, it's clear it's not because of the interaction with the star, but because of precession of the accretion disk. But still, I just wanted to show you just so that you see that these structures are actually there. So the jets are not only straight lines, but they are curved. Now, just let me go a bit into more detail because I'm just going to, just for Edgar, a couple of-
you, Edgar, do you want to make the stop now or?
Well, yes, okay, we can do it now, yes, because it's in the middle of the talk, more or less. Yes, okay. Yes.
Questions? Well, I have one. How do you, in these simulations, no? How do you model the jet? What kind of physics you put in? How do you do these calculations? What is the model?
Well, these simulations, I did not participate in these ones.
Yeah.
So I don't know much the details about this, but basically you have some basic ingredients, which are the jet power, the jet Lorentz factor. You assume an initial shape of the conical expansion. And well, the stellar wind has also density, mass loss rate, and so on. And well, and from there, the initial status is just, in these ones in particular, I think it's just the stellar wind, and then you inject the jet. So you don't have a jet from the start. Now I'm not sure. In some cases you have the jet, let's say a stationary jet already formed, and then you introduce the stellar wind afterwards and see how this evolves. But in this case, I think the jet is injected from the left with these properties that I was mentioning, and you just let him evolve, and then you see all these structures forming here. But the details of the simulations, I don't know.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm Valentí Bosch. I'm in the street. I'm sorry if I'm not very clear. But just to quickly say that the simulations Edgar is referring to, they were done assuming just ideal gas evolving adiabatically. And I think this, we use a relativistic code, which includes special relativity, and basically the rest is what Edgar said. So we can put the jet from the beginning with certain characteristics and let the wind interact, or you can inject the jet inside a medium filled by the stellar wind. And that's it.
Okay, thank you. The final pictures you show, Edgar, are real data, no? These are
radio observations. So
and the simulations, do they reproduce the features you mentioned? Or?
Well, the simulations are just, these ones are just hydrodynamics. So there is, And also these scales are much smaller. So these scales are basically within the binary system. And these things are much, much larger than the binary system. So the radio structure, we can see the jets normally in radio up to, let's say, thousands of tens of thousands of times the binary separation.
I see.
So they are tracing different scales, these observations and the simulation runs I was showing.
In fact, for example, the SS433 is a system where it thought that the variation of the bending of the jet is produced by precession of the jet. So it's these long changes, these large, are because the jet is precessing. Other question is how affect the wind of the companion star to the jet, but this is a smaller scales and near to the basement of the jet.
Yeah, well, I think I mentioned something, or this accretion, this precession, yes. So in this case, it's not, so the wind may have some influence there, but this structure is not, at least, not the biggest effect is not the wind in this case. For Cygnus X1 and Cygnus X3, it's not so clear.
So one other question I have is, you know, you say that in the model where you have interaction with the wind and then production of the jet there, essentially you initially have a kind of conical outflow, then with interaction with the wind, this can be collimated and become a much narrower jet. So I guess what I'd like to understand is how broad can this initial conical jet maybe, how broad can it be? And then how much narrower in terms of the opening angle can it get by this recollimation in the collision with the wind material?
Well, for jets, typical opening angles are around 10 degrees.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say more or less something like that. Yes.
But then when it gets farther away, it can get much narrower, you say, due to some process in the collision of the wind.
When you have this, in this case, yes, the opening angle can get smaller. But this happens in a region, then at some point, once you move farther and farther away and the wind density decreases again, then the jet can, let's say, resume its expansion as well.
Its lateral expansion, okay. But so basically it is some process of the magnetic field that tends to, for some reason, collimate the jet, so make it narrower.
Initially, yes. Well, the process of jet collimation, as far as I know, is still also not fully understood. But initially, yes, the collimation of the jets happens at very small scales, so very close to the black hole or the neutron star.
Okay, but this collision with the wind, then it's a different process.
Yes, this recollimation with the wind is just a matter of the pressure of the ambient that you have there. Because as the jet expands, its lateral pressure is decreasing, and in these scales, the medium, the pressure of the medium is more or less the same, because the distance to the star, which is what regulates this, the density of the stellar wind as well, it's more or less constant at these scales.
Mm-hmm.
So this is why at some point these pressures are equal and the jet cannot longer expand. It can maybe still expand, but then not so wide, let's say.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
So the ambient density control then.
Sorry. Edgar, can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm sorry, because I'm in the school of my kid, so there was this
alarm. This is the bell, yes.
Yes, yes, I'm sorry. So the question is that there is asymmetrical, strongly asymmetrical collimation. So on one side of the jet you have collimation, but on the other side you have strong expansion. So what Jordi is talking about is probably just apparent, because actually the jet gets broader.
Okay, the overlap shape, yes, okay. So, well, yeah, in this picture, maybe it can be better seen. So the star is here, so the jet is collimated from the side of the, facing the stellar wind, let's say, but it's widened in the other direction. Okay, so should I continue, or we still have some minutes of the of this break?
Okay, Luca, I have a very elemental question. Is that jet always perpendicular to the orbital plane, observationally?
No. I mean, this, for example, is one case. SS433 is one where it is not the case. Because sometimes in what I've been telling, I've been assuming that the, so okay, let's go back to this picture, that the accretion disk is in the same plane as the orbital plane. And the jets are perpendicular to the accretion disk. What may happen, as is the case for SS433, is that the accretion disk is precessing, so it's not in the same plane, not even in the same plane, but its orientation is changing with respect to the orbital plane. And this also makes the jet precess. And this is the origin of this structure in SS433, for instance. So the answer is no, it doesn't need to be like this necessarily. And this is always one of the possible explanations that are there for this curved shape yet.
So this curved structure in Cygnus X3, do you have a sort of three-dimensional information of the velocity change along the curvature?
Not that I know of. I'm not sure.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
I mean, in this particular paper, this is a flare of 1999, I think. They proposed the precession model to explain this, but well, it's still, as far as I know, it's still not very clear what's the origin of this. Also, because you see this only when you have these big flares. It's not that you see this structure at such large scale continuously.
Okay. So if there is no further questions, we can continue.
Okay. Well, then what I was going to tell, just a bit more detail, because I'm going to explain the model that we developed here. The trajectory computation is it's a phenomenological one. So basically we take into account these effects that I was telling you before in a phenomenological way. We initially have this jet that is moving perpendicular to the orbital plane. In this case, we assume everything, the accretion disk is also in the same plane. And it's bent away by the wind of the star. Then we have orbital motion and we have this ellipse-like shape. Here's the resulting trajectory of the jet axis. So that would be the central part of the jet, let's see. Let's say for two Lorentz factors. And these dashed lines are the projections on the orbital plane. Okay, so you see this kind of ellipse structure. And one thing is that the parameters of the jet of the wind and the wind have to be in a range where this is relevant. What I mean with this is that, for instance, as we saw in the simulations before, if the jet is has a very low power, then it may be broken already at very small scale, so already very close to the star because of the stellar wind. And on the other hand, if the jet is very powerful, then the bending is smaller. And it's like, if the jet is very powerful, it's like it doesn't care about the wind, let's say it like this. So we don't see this structure, or at least not significantly. So we have to be in a range of jet powers where both the jet survives and leaves the binary system and is sufficiently bent so that this structure is seen. Okay, so now once we have this structure computed, we inject non-thermal particles, in our case leptons or electrons and positrons, in the recollimation where the recollimation happens due to the wind, because there we have shocks, and where we have strong shocks we can also have particle accelerations up to high energies. And then as these particles move around this helical trajectory, they cool down via different processes and radiate through synchrotron and inverse quantum mechanisms. And okay, one thing that we can see, for instance, in this plot is, let's say we assume we have this jet, helical jet, and then we assume that we have another jet there. Or we compare it with another jet that is just moves as a straight line. It's like this jet doesn't care. Although this is not realistic, but to compare if there are differences in the emission in the emission outputs of these two cases. And this is what is done in the purple lines, which are the bent jets, and the green lines that are the straight jets. These are light curves, so we have fluxes as a function of the orbital phase, with zero being the phase where the jet is pointing towards the observer, and 0.5 the other one, so the jet is pointing away from the observer. And we see that, okay, in some cases it's close, but in some cases and some specific orbital phases we have significant differences. In the case of these helical jets, we have also this asymmetry caused by the geometry itself. And also a thing that we see here, and in general it's very important in these systems and very relevant for the emission outputs, is the observer orientation. So it's very important if the jet is pointing towards us or it's pointing perpendicular to us, because this has effects in many processes as inverse quantum, beaming of the emission, absorption mechanisms, and so on. This is okay. The spectral energy distribution of the results of this model. What we see, since we are probing here regions close to the binary systems, we basically all the radio emission is absorbed. At these regions, and we have here the two components. This one is the synchrotron one, so this is the synchrotron emission, and this one is the inverse quantum emission for different orbital phases here. And you see that inverse quantum has a much higher dependence with the orbital phase, for instance. And I only show this for one observer orientation, but if we change the observer orientation, then the differences between these lines also change. So this is why I was saying that the orientation is an important parameter also regarding the emission outputs. Okay, I have to go a bit faster. These are the radio maps. So as I said, close to the binary system, the radio is absorbed because we have a free absorption with the stellar wind ions absorb the radio photons. But when we move to higher distances, we can trace the jet shape by their radio emission, as we were seeing for the Cygnus X3 and Cygnus X1 and SS433. And this is kind of the simulated radio mass that we get from our model. This is for two different inclinations. This is for a 30 degree inclination, and this is a 60. So this is the system seen more edge on, and this is seen more face on. And we can start already to see with current resolutions and sensitivity of radio interferometers, we can already start seeing some helical structure here according to the predictions of our model. Okay, so now I move on to the other kind of systems that I wanted to talk about, which are non-accreting pulsar binaries. This can be this very nice picture that I found the other day. I think it depicts quite well how this system works. We have the massive star here with this powerful stellar wind. And then we have a pulsar that is a fastly rotating neutron star. And here, what we don't have yet, the pulsar itself is not accreting matter, as happened with microquasars. But we have this collision of winds, because pulsars have also very strong winds, very fast, ultra-relativistic winds. And the collision of the pulsar wind and the stellar wind, it's what creates the relativistic outflow responsible for the non-thermal emission in this scenario. And again, the processes are similar, the processes in play are similar as in microquasars. So we have shocks that accelerate particles, and then these particles radiate via synchrotron, via inverse Compton, and other non-thermal processes. So again, here orbital motion is important. And yes. One parameter that regulates, let's say, how this interaction between the stellar and the pulsar wind works is this ratio, which is basically the momentum rate of the pulsar wind. So this is the mass loss rate of the pulsar wind times the velocity of the pulsar wind, which is basically the speed of light, and the same quantity for the stellar wind. So the higher this number is, the more powerful is the pulsar wind with respect to the stellar wind. And for typical cases, we have this number smaller than one. But this regulates. This is a simulation, the initial state of a simulation of this kind of systems. We have the star here in the center of this red circle, the pulsar in the center of this light blue circle. And this is the stellar wind, which is radial in the star direction, and the pulsar wind that flows in a cone behind the pulsar, let's say. So once we add orbital motion, in this case in a counterclockwise direction, that's the kind of structures that we see. In this case, this motion is or these structures move mainly in the orbital plane by the same nature of the sources. And you see again this spiral-like structure. Again, this, as I said, this parameter is important because the higher this parameter is, for instance, the wider this cone gets, the less bent or the less affected the pulsar wind is by the stellar wind, and so on. So one can have an idea on how important would be the interaction between the two winds with a simplified calculation like this one. We know when the interaction in the interface between the pulsar and stellar wind, there is a contact discontinuity. So a region where the pressures of the two winds are equal. And initially this can be approximated to have a conical shape, again, like we can see here. So here we will have the pulsar, here will be the star. And initially it moves more or less conically with an angle that can be a half opening angle that can be approximated by this. Again, you see the eta parameter here. And in this region, in the interface between the two winds, so we have here regions of shocked pulsar wind and shocked stellar wind as well in these interaction regions between the two winds. But in the inner regions, the pulsar wind remains largely unshocked until it reaches a point, which is what we call the Coriolis turnover, which is, we can say, where the dynamics of this flow is dominated by the stellar wind and the orbital motion. So this is intuitively seen here. This, the pulsar wind moves more or less in a straight line, and then it reaches this point where it gets the impact of the stellar wind, and then it starts bending around. Here we can think of two main sites where particles are accelerated. One of them is in the wind standoff location, in the two wind standoff location, which is the place where the two winds are colliding frontally. So the pulsar wind and the stellar wind are colliding frontally. And the other one is this Coriolis turnover, where the dynamics starts being dominated by the orbital motion. Here again, I show some observations of this kind of systems. In this case, LS5039, it's not clear. So there are models suggesting it is either a microquasar or a non-accreting pulsar binary. But you can see again radio observations with some orbital phases show some asymmetries, but they are not definitive to distinguish between one or the other scenario. And here we have another one, which in this case, it is confirmed to be a pulsar, the compact object. And you can see also the extended radio emission, which is displaced from the center of the binary system, which is marked with the red cross. So, okay, again, going to the model that we did to study this kind of systems. The idea is very similar to the microquasar, but microquasars, the main flow direction was perpendicular to the orbital plane. Now we have the motion mainly in the orbital plane. In this case, we have non-thermal particles injected in both the initial, the standoff shock and the Coriolis shock. So in these two locations, as I was showing before. And this separates, okay, let's go back. This separates the flow into two distinct regions. So basically from here, between the two ellipses, we have one region, and beyond the second ellipse, we have a second region of non-thermal particles and thus of non-thermal emission.
Edgar, you have 3 minutes.
Okay, I will go a bit faster then. But the idea is that radiative outputs are not much more different that at least at the naked eye. It's not easy to spot very a lot of differences between a microquasar scenario and a non-accreting pulsar scenario. This is why there are some sources in which it is not clear. So it's seen thermal emission, it seems. And they seem to be compatible with two scenarios depending on the parameters one chooses. Okay, again, this is the light curve. I don't have time for this. We see also we can make the radio maps as we did for the jets, the simulated radio maps for these systems. Here we see the dependence with a magnetic field, for instance. This is for a low magnetic field with results in low synchrotron emission, and those radio emission is lower. And when we assume a higher magnetic field, of course, we have much more synchrotron emission, and we can trace the structure better in this case. And just a few words on some additional elements that I didn't talk about in this talk, but introduce more complexity in the system. In these systems, first of all, is the high eccentric orbits. Because in these highly eccentric orbits, what happens is that when the pulsar is close to the apastron, basically the pulsar wind there is, since it's so far from the star, it's not that much affected by the stellar wind, and it breaks this spiral-like structure. This is what you can see in this. So here you have like three different rings, but close to apastron, which is where the source is now, these rings are broken because the pulsar wind just goes in this direction and is not significantly bent. This is one thing that may affect the radiation outputs. Another thing is the presence of a decretion disk in the star. So BE stars that have a very strong equatorial wind. This may influence because also when the compact object is crossing this decretion disk, there can be flaring episodes. This can result also in superorbital modulations, as happens for LSI plus 61303, and so on. So this is again another thing that can affect the radiation outputs. And finally, wind clamping. So everything that I've been telling you about is assuming a isotropic wind for the star, isotropic and homogeneous. But we know that massive stars have likely clumpy winds, so with regions of higher density. And this also affects the interaction with the jets. This is, again, simulations, but now assuming clumpy winds, as you can see in these yellow circles. And here is another simulation for a single clamp. The idea is that this can affect both the dynamics, because it can make jet disruption more easy. It can affect, in general, the dynamics on how this interaction works, and also the radiation. It can have a significant influence in the radiation outputs of the jets, the fact of assuming a clamp. And just to finish, because I think I was a bit late, we have two main scenarios for these high binary systems with relativistic outflows: microquasars and non-accreting pulsar binaries. The presence of a massive star as a companion is very important, and it has to be taken into account because the interactions between it and the outflows is there and has influence both dynamically and radiatively. It can affect trajectory, particle reacceleration. It can even break the outflow in the case of a weak jet, as we saw. There are some cases where both scenarios cannot be distinguished because the radiative outputs are quite similar. And here I put here two sources where the microquasar or the non-accreting pulsar scenario are feasible. And finally, additional elements that I just mentioned briefly in the end may introduce further complexity in the system and affect it both dynamically and radiatively. So this can make the system even more complex than what I told you. And that's it. Thank you, and sorry for taking a bit longer.
Very good.
Is there any questions from the audience?
Well, I'd like to have one. I raised my hand. I suppose other people can raise hands too in the reactions. So my question is, basically, I understand a lot of the observations of these jets are in the radio. And right now, we know that the highest resolution has been achieved in the radio for this Event Horizon telescope, where they reach, frequencies of 300 gigahertz and resolutions as good as 10 to minus 5 arc seconds or so on. Here you said you have about 10 of these objects or binary systems that are known. So do you know what is the highest resolution that has been achieved in observing this jet emission?
In these cases, I think best things it's around 1 milliarcsecond resolution or something like this. So the typical beam sizes for the best cases are around 1 milliarcsecond.
Mm-hmm. And what are the frequencies at which one observes this?
Typically, it's 5 gigahertz, 8 gigahertz, 10, okay. Something like this.
So do you think there is an interest in going to even higher resolution to observe any of the very small scale structures?
The problem in radio is that it's very absorbed close to the star. Mm-hmm. So if you go very close to the star, there's the radio photons are absorbed by the wind ions, and it's what is called the free absorption. So one needs to move a bit farther from the binary system to or go to higher frequencies as well to be able to observe these very small scale structures at the binary system level. But the event horizon you told me is 300 gigahertz.
Well, I think there, because they want to go to such high resolution, then they one of the ways to do it is to go to the highest frequency you can. So I was wondering if for this there would be any advantage going to also try to go to higher frequencies.
Yes, at these frequencies, maybe you can get quite close to the binary system. But yes, you really need very, very good resolutions because the distances. Typically, the orbital separations for the typical distances of these systems is of the order of 10 to the minus 1, so 10 to the minus 4 arc seconds or something like that. So you really need very, very good resolutions if you want to go to very to this small scales.
Thank you.
Yeah, I had another question, Edgar. Thank you very much for your seminar. I was wondering if either with the jet structure or with the other radio pictures you have, can you say something about the compact object and its properties? Mass, radius, magnetic field.
Okay, let me go to one picture. You mean from the observations, right?
Well, either way, whether maybe by fitting their simulation.
Mm-hmm. Okay, the magnetic, there's one thing here that you have some degree of degeneracy between several parameters that are not well known, which the magnetic field is one of them, the budget of energy of non-thermal particles is another and so on. But for instance, okay, now I went to, for instance, you know that the synchrotron emission is the responsible of the radio emission of these systems. So you can somehow constrain, yes, the magnetic field by the but how much emission you have in radio at different parts of the jet from the compact object. Mass, I don't think so that you can have an idea from here, no. Magnetic field, yes, you can constrain. And well, in the end, you have a combination of parameters that you can more or less constrain with the observations. But as I said, there is this degeneracy that it's very difficult to say just this can only be explained with a given magnetic field because maybe a different combination of magnetic field and other parameters that play a role there gives similar observational results.
I understand, thank you.
Well, I think we are a little bit late, but we officially finished the talk right now. But if somebody wants to stay a little bit more to ask questions or discuss, you are welcome. So let's thank again.
Thank you,
Edgar, and thank you all for coming.
Thank you.